Thank you. That concludes general questions. The next item of business is First Minister's questions. And at question number one, I call Douglas Ross.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. New statistics released this week revealed that January of this year was the worst month ever for long waits at Scotland's A&E departments. Almost 9,000 patients waited over half a day for emergency treatment. We spoke to Kirstine Campbell from Rossshire. She spent over 7 hours in a waiting room at the Queen Elizabeth University Hospital after experiencing symptoms of a heart attack or blood clot during a visit to Clydebank. To alleviate the pain she was in, Kirstine had to lie on the floor. She told me, surrounded by vomit and other bodily fluids, because there was no bed available. So what does Hamza Youssef have to say to Kirstine, and how is he going to fix this problem?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, before I answer Douglas Ross's question, I did want to just say, and on behalf of the Scottish Government and indeed the party that I lead, that how sad we were about the tragic news of the loss of Nick Sheridan. Nick was an extremely talented journalist and author. He'll be greatly missed. Many of us in this chamber will have been questioned by Nick quite robustly, no doubt, whether it was on BBC Drive Time or many of the other programmes that he presented. My thoughts are with his family, his many friends, and indeed his colleagues. It will undoubtedly be a very sad time indeed, Presiding Officer. In terms of the question that Douglas Ross asks, a very serious question, of course, indeed, what I would say to Kirstine Campbell and anybody else that's had to wait too long is, first and foremost, this government apologises to anybody who has to wait longer than any of us would expect in relation to A&E treatment or indeed when it comes to elective care or diagnostics. But it is precisely because we're still recovering from that global pandemic, which has affected every single health service in the country, that the Deputy First Minister stood here and ensured that we have record funding, over £19.5 billion of funding going into the NHS. It's also why, of course, we ensured that those who are at the front line, who are dealing with the likes of Kirstine, treating Kirstine, caring for Kirstine, and many other patients across Scotland, we ensure that they're the best paid in the entire UK. It's why we ensured that we increased their pay to record levels. It's why, of course, we've also increased staffing levels by historic highs under this government. So is the long waits, are the long waits that too many patients have to endure acceptable? Not at all. And that is why we're investing in our NHS. That's why we're investing in our staff. What makes that far more difficult, of course, is when we have those real-term budget cuts that come from Westminster, that slash public spending, not just in NHS England, but then have a consequence here in Scotland. So this government will continue to invest in our NHS, but most crucially, continue to invest in our NHS staff, who do an incredible job day in and day out.
Douglas Ross.
On behalf of the Scottish Conservatives, can I also pay tribute to Nick Sheridan? I have been interviewed by him in the past, and he was a robust but extremely professional journalist, and I know his loss will be felt so much by his family and his friends, and in particular his colleagues at the BBC and across the media, with whom he was so highly regarded. But I listened carefully to the First Minister's answer there, and the example I gave about Kirstine and A&E departments in question one is replicated across our NHS. This week, we also learned that patients are nearly 30 times more likely to be waiting over 2 years for treatment in Scotland's NHS than they would be south of the border. There are more than 8,000 patients waiting over 2 years for treatment in Scotland's NHS. 8,000 waiting over 2 years. Does Hamza Youssef think it's acceptable for one person, never mind thousands, to wait more than 2 years for treatment? And what is he planning to do specifically to deal with these appalling waits for treatment?
First Minister.
I said in my first response that we don't believe that anybody who has to endure a long wait, be it for unscheduled care, be it for elective care, be it for diagnostics, is acceptable. But we also, of course, all understand, I hope, that the impact of the global pandemic has affected health services, not just in Scotland, but right across the world. Douglas Ross asks, what are we doing about it? It's because of our investment in the NHS, because of that record investment in the NHS, that we are seeing progress, we are seeing recovery. If I looked at the statistics that were out this week that Douglas Ross references, for example, we saw that in operations performed, there was an increase in January of 15% compared to the month before. And in fact, if you compare to January from the year before, there was a 16% increase. That shows, of course, activity moving in the right directions. In January, we saw January of this year, 702 operations carried out each day. That compares to 604 in the January prior. We look at long waits. There have been some, again, elements of recovery. We look at those who are waiting over 2 years in terms of new outpatients. That's down 66%. If I look at two-year inpatients and day cases, down 25%. And Douglas Ross asks again, what specifically are you doing about it? Well, we're making sure that we're investing in our capacity. That's why, through our network of treatment centres, for example, 20,000 additional surgeries, we've provided that capacity. But I go back to my central point and end in this point, Presiding Officer. We're investing record amounts in our NHS. We're investing in our staff. We're making sure they're the best paid. That job becomes immeasurably difficult when we have a UK government that is taking £500 million over, out of our budget in real terms over the last 2 years. And for that, Douglas Ross really needs to use whatever influence, and we know, of course, he doesn't have much influence, but whatever influence
briefly,
he
First
has
Minister.
To make sure that the Conservatives fund public services, not slash them to the bone.
Douglas Ross.
I think it's really important when we're speaking about our NHS and patients, we speak to those 8,000 people across Scotland who are suffering, waiting over 2 years.
We'll just suspend this meeting briefly. Thank you, colleagues. We will resume our business, and I go to Douglas Ross.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I was saying to the 8,000 people in Scotland waiting more than 2 years for treatment, they want to hear more from Scotland's First Minister about how he is going to deal with this. And unsurprisingly, Hamza Youssef is still blaming COVID, but the crisis in Scotland's NHS has continued to get worse since the pandemic. Since Hamza Youssef became First Minister, more than 500,000 days have been lost due to delayed discharge. That means over the last 12 months, 500,000 hospital beds that could have been available for other patients. Now, the SNP promised, they promised to eradicate delayed discharge 8 years ago. If they'd done that, as they promised, but I think the First Minister just said that's stupid. It was a promise. It was a promise. It was a promise. From
colleagues,
the SNP
colleagues,
government.
Colleagues, let's conduct our business in an orderly fashion.
We're disagreeing with something, so I'll be interested to know, is the First Minister disagreeing that it was a promise to eradicate completely delayed discharge 8 years ago? Because if they had done that, waiting times would have been lower for emergency care, for ambulances and for emergency treatment. So can I ask Hamza Youssef, how costly has that failure to eradicate delayed discharge been to patients waiting in Scotland's NHS?
First Minister.
First of all, Presiding Officer, Douglas Ross really should withdraw and retract his comment. I didn't say anything, in fact. Well, Douglas Ross, I didn't say anything, actually.
Colleagues, First Minister, if I might just ask you to take a seat. It's exceptionally important that we conduct our business in an orderly fashion. The way that we can best do that is not to shout and point at one another. It's to ensure that when the person who's been called to speak, they have an opportunity to do that and that we listen respectfully. First Minister.
Yes, and that's right, Presiding Officer. I mean, Douglas Ross, clearly, having been left hung out to dry by his own colleagues, is desperate to simply just make up what is being said or not being said. And what I would say, Presiding Officer, in terms of when it comes to the NHS here in Scotland, I'm very proud of the fact that the actions that we have taken means that Scotland remains the only country in the UK where we've not lost a single day to NHS strike action anywhere in the UK. And when it comes to social care, which Douglas Ross is absolutely right to point to, Brexit, of course, has been a complete and utter disaster for social care recruitment. And not only that, the recent changes to migration and the migration rules have been described as absolutely devastating by those who work in social care, presiding officer. Add to that what I've already said, a real terms cut to our budget over the last couple of years, and indeed a £1.3 billion cut to our capital, which directly affects health infrastructure, then we are attempting to recover our NHS in the face of over 14 years of Conservative austerity, presiding officer. So the Scottish Government, the SNP-led Scottish Government, will invest in our NHS, make sure we have record staffing levels, the best paid NHS staff anywhere in the UK, and will continue to make sure that we invest in our public services while Douglas Ross and his party take a hatchet to public services right across the UK.
Douglas Ross.
Last week, one whistleblower in NHS Grampian revealed to the Press and Journal paper that at one stage, 18 ambulances were stuck outside Aberdeen Royal Infirmary. The whistleblower said this could have been up to half of the North East fleet of ambulances stuck in one place, unable to leave, instead of supporting and protecting the communities we serve. I can repeat this if the First Minister is getting advice from the Health Secretary, because I think it's really important.
Please continue, Mr. Ross.
I think it's really important that the First Minister listens to what our professionals are saying in Scotland's NHS. Because this whistleblower in NHS Grampian continued. What? Is that the response we're going to get from a Cabinet Secretary in this Scottish Government? And I hope that is withdrawn.
Mr. Ross, can I just say that I did not hear the comment that you have obviously heard, Mr. Ross, from the floor, but it is absolutely essential that members desist from any commentary when their colleagues are putting questions to one another and responding to them. We are not going to continue in this vein. I would be grateful if members would remind themselves of standing orders and the need to treat one another with courtesy and respect. Mr. Ross.
I can't believe Angus Robertson is smirking after seeing that when I am quoting from an ambulance worker in NHS Grampian. So I will continue to read out their words because they seem to be uncomfortable for this SNP government. This whistleblower in NHS Grampian continued, "Many of my colleagues share a concern that we are unable to help those most in need because we're tied up at hospital and not where they need us to be." And this is happening across Scotland. We spoke to Ian Black, who gave up waiting for an ambulance after 15 hours when he was told that Monklands Hospital was full. When he eventually got an ambulance the following morning, it emerged he'd suffered a stroke. Ian's still alive to explain his situation, but if this happened to other people, they might not be. Waiting 15 hours for an ambulance after a stroke will be fatal in other circumstances. So will the First Minister please take this more seriously than others on his front bench and tell us what urgent action he is taking to stop ambulances being stuck outside Scotland's hospitals, because people will lose their lives if he does not.
First Minister.
Officer, of course we take this issue seriously. I'm not sure why Douglas Ross is so rattled this session of First Minister's questions. He mentioned the Press and Journal. It may be something to do, of course, with a great paper which I read many on regularity, presiding officer.
Members.
In terms of the health challenges that those across the country are facing, and no doubt that the Scottish Ambulance Service also facing those challenges. That is why we've increased the funding for the Scottish Ambulance Service in the next financial year. And of course, in this financial year, we assured that the Scottish Ambulance Service was provided £50 million. That funding, of course, helped them recruit an additional 317 staff by April of this year. So we're increasing the staff, recruiting more staff where we possibly can. There is no getting away from the fact, Presiding Officer, that the global pandemic impacted on health services right across the country, and including, of course, here in Scotland. Despite that, and thanks to the effort of incredible paramedics, incredible Agenda for Change staff, incredible doctors up and down this country, that's why we have and continue to have the best performing A&E in comparison to other parts of the UK. It's why we have the best paid staff in comparison to the UK. It's why we have more qualified nurses and midwives per head than in England. That's why we've not lost a single day of NHS activity to strike action. It's why when we look at waiting times, for example, we have made improvements and recovery, but there is still far more for us to do. So this government is not just committed to the NHS, we'll support it in its greatest hour of need by ensuring it has that record investment, that record over £19.5 billion investment, in very stark contrast to the UK Conservative government that has slashed public spending to the absolute bone so that Douglas Ross and high earners can get a tax cut. That is the wrong priorities, yeah, Presiding Officer.
Question number two, Anna Sarwar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer.
We will suspend briefly. We'll resume once more, and at question number two, I call Anna Sarwar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I start by echoing the comments about Nick Sheridan? He was a young, talented and charismatic journalist with a huge future ahead of him, and our thoughts are with his family, friends and all his colleagues at the BBC. Presiding Officer, when we're discussing issues of life and death in our NHS, I think, frankly, patients across Scotland deserve better than what they've seen in the last 20 minutes here at First Minister's Questions. The treatment time guarantee is a legally binding maximum waiting time of 12 weeks from referral to treatment. How many times have the SNP government broken this law?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, well, I don't have that figure to hand. There's no doubt, of course, that we have seen increases in waits and long waits due again to the global pandemic. We know there was challenges before the global pandemic, and that's fair to reference, but we're also making progress in terms of those long waits. But we are investing in a recovery, and that's why we've seen, for example, operations that were performed in January of this year increasing by 15% in comparison to the month before. But these are challenges that are faced right across the UK. If I look at the data for the 31st of December 2023, it shows that in Scotland there were 124 patients per 1,000 of the population for treatment time guarantee that were waiting, and new outpatient appointments as well. This is fewer in England, where 134 patients per 1,000 are on the RTT, referral to treatment waiting list, and Wales, where the figure is 244 per 1,000. So that is cold comfort, of course, to those that are waiting in Scotland. But the point being, of course, these are issues that are impacting our health service right across the UK. So I go back to the point I was making to Douglas Ross, to Anna Sarwar. We are investing in that recovery and beginning to see progress in relation to the reduction of those who are waiting the longest, and indeed in terms of activity in the NHS going up. So this government will continue to invest in our NHS with record funding of over £19.5 billion.
Anna Sarwar.
Presiding Officer, it is written in law that a patient should be treated within 12 weeks. The SNP have broken this law over 680,000 times. And Hamza Yousaf might try and blame the pandemic, but this law was broken over 320,000 times before COVID. Shona Robison broke the law 158,000 times. Michael Matheson broke the law 184,000 times. And Hamza Yousaf broke the law 235,000 times. And since he published his so-called NHS recovery plan, the SNP have broken the law 306,735 times. Every one of these breaches is someone waiting anxiously for a medical procedure, often in pain. Many have put their lives on hold, stopped work or retired because of their condition, and too many of them have been forced to go private in the middle of a cost of living crisis just to stop the pain. So, First Minister, will you apologise to the 680,000 people your government has failed by breaking this law?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, I already said to, in response to Douglas Ross, of course this government apologises and regrets anybody having to wait longer, whether it's for unscheduled care, whether it's for long waits, whether it's treatment time guarantees. We, of course, don't want a single person waiting longer, a day longer, a minute longer than they have to do. But what Anna Sawar does is completely ignores the impact of a pandemic. He does this every time he talks about the health service. The pandemic, of course, was the biggest shock our NHS has faced in its 75-year existence. There was, of course, progress being made in relation to waiting times before the pandemic, but, of course, there's no doubt that the impact of the global pandemic has been severe on our health service. I go back to the point that we are beginning to see some improvements. We're beginning to see activity increase when it comes to, for example, those who've waited the longest, those two-year waits for outpatients. We've seen a reduction of new outpatient appointments, a reduction by 66% from the end of June 22, and for those inpatients, or day case treatments, reduced by around about a quarter. And what are we doing about that? We're ensuring an increased capacity for 20,000 additional surgeries. We've also provided 7 mobile MRI and 3 mobile CT scanners to increase
First Minister.
Additional activity. And we're also supporting mobile operating theatres right up and down the country. But I go back to the point I made to Douglas Ross and Anna Sawar, that we're doing all of this in the face of 14 years of UK Tory austerity and a real terms cut to our budget. Much better for us that we had control over our own finances so we wouldn't be at the behest of cruel Westminster governments who continue to cut our budget, Presiding Officer.
Anna Sawar.
Presiding Officer, 17 years in government and that's the best answer they've got, seriously. Because across nearly every measure, this government has failed. They have broken the treatment time guarantee law 680,000 times, 320,000 times before the pandemic. Now, Hamza Yousaf wants to pretend that things are getting better. But let's look at the NHS stats published just this week. A third of patients not being seen within 4 hours in our A&Es. Over 8,500 people waiting more than 12 hours in 1 month. 55,000 fewer planned operations in the past year compared to before the pandemic. 5,500 children waiting to receive mental health treatment. And 1 in 5 people getting crucial bowel cancer tests. Only 1 in 5 people getting crucial bowel cancer tests on time. Shocking when cancer remains Scotland's biggest killer. So, First Minister, do you accept that waiting time standards exist for a reason? That every time they are missed, it puts lives at risk, and that your government's incompetence is destroying the NHS and failing staff and patients?
First Minister.
It is, of course.
We will suspend once more. I call upon the First Minister to respond.
Presiding Officer, let me go back to, of course, the fact of the matter that the global pandemic has undoubtedly caused real challenges for health services right across the UK, including in Labour-run Wales and Conservative-run England, and, of course, where we are in charge here of the NHS in Scotland. But statistics this week have also, of course, shown the output, the outcome of that record investment that we made in the NHS, i.e. headcount in the NHS is at record high levels. And also, of course, that we have made improvements in CAMHS as well, that was referenced by Anna Sawar. Still improvements to be made, still work to be done. But we continue to see sustained improvements in CAMHS weights. National performance against the 18-week CAMHS standard, the fourth highest since records began, the highest achieved since quarter ending March 2016. We've also seen increases in CAMHS staffing as well. But I end on the point that I made to Anna Sarwar and indeed to Douglas Ross a moment ago. We know that the NHS is struggling as a result of the global pandemic. That's why we're investing over £19.5 billion in the most precious institution, our National Health Service. But we're doing that in the face of a real terms cut over the last couple of years from the Conservative government. What makes that even more difficult, of course, is that when Labour's general election coordinator is asked if he disagrees with a single Conservative budget proposal, he says no. They have the same spending plans as the Conservatives. So whether it's Labour austerity or Conservative austerity, Presiding Officer, Westminster austerity is going to continue to undoubtedly impact and damage our public services. And in the face of that, this government makes no apologies for record investment in our NHS.
Question number 3, Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what action the Scottish Government can take to help encourage children into sport and cultivate future world-class athletes in the light of recent successes of Josh Kerr and Gemma Reekie at the World Indoor Athletics Championships in Glasgow.
First Minister.
Well, let me also offer huge congratulations to both Josh and Gemma on their fantastic medal-winning performances. Let me also thank the team at Glasgow and all those involved and, of course, the World Indoor Athletic Championships for the incredible work that they have done in putting on a spectacular championships earlier this month. We know that being physically active is one of the best things that all children and young people can do to help their social, physical and, of course, their mental well-being as well. As set out in the programme for government, we're working with Sport Scotland to ensure active schools programmes are free for all children and young people by the end of this parliament, providing them with more opportunities to take part in sport before, during and after school. Sport Scotland's investment helps to support key partners, to deliver programmes that address the inequalities that exist in access to sport and physical activity by increasing participation, creating a pathway for success at every level in all sports. We will ensure anyone in Scotland does and can achieve their full potential.
Brian Whittle.
Can I thank the First Minister for that answer and quickly point out that we don't just have Josh and Gemma, we also have previous world 1500 metre champion Jake Whiteman and Olympic medalist Laura Muir in the middle distance events, or to give middle distance events their full title, proper sport. I cannot wait for the Olympics. But First Minister, as much as these athletes are inspirational to our young budding sports people, these young people have to be able to access sport. School sport is on the decline and local authorities are closing so many of our public sports facilities, or at least having to increase charges. Access to sport is on a very steep decline. So can I ask the First Minister, with the huge societal, community, health and educational benefits that sport brings, does he agree with me that cutting those opportunities for participation is a false economy?
First Minister. We will suspend once more. We will resume once more, and I call Brian Whittle.
I've asked my question. I'll do it again if you like.
Smashing. That being the case, I call the First Minister.
In fairness, Presiding Officer, it was a good question. I don't think Brian Whittle has to repeat it. Can I say to Brian Whittle, I know he's had a long-standing, of course, interest himself, of course, being an accomplished athlete. I was going to say at one time, but I think still continues to be an accomplished athlete of sorts, Presiding Officer. I will stop digging and move on, Presiding Officer. Brian Whittle was right to mention Jake Whiteman, Laura Muir, Dash Eilish McColgan, and of course many other of our fantastic Scottish athletes to that list. What I would say, to give some reassurance to Brian Whittle if I can, across 23-24, Sport Scotland are investing £36.7 million of Scottish Government and National Lottery funding into Scottish governing bodies of sports, and this increase represents an 8.6% increase in the previous year. But his point is well made around local facilities. That's why this government is providing local government with record funding of more than £14 billion. That's a real terms increase, despite the real terms budget cuts that I mentioned. But I go back to the point I've made throughout this First Minister's questions, Presiding Officer. This would be far easier to support local government, to support our sports facilities, if we weren't facing a £500 million cut over 2 years to our budget, or indeed a £1.3 billion cut to our capital budget. So any influence at all that the Scottish Tories have, which seems very minimal indeed, to help their Conservative colleagues down in the UK government to make sure they're spending on public services would be much appreciated.
Fulton MacGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Having the opportunity to share in sporting victories can play an important part in helping to encourage children into sport. Does the First Minister therefore agree with me that showing Scotland's men's and women's football matches on free-to-air TV could help to inspire the next generation of talent? Can he advise what steps can be taken to open up these games to as wide an audience as possible?
First Minister.
Yeah, I do agree with Fulton MacGregor in his question. I agree that we want to ensure our children don't miss out on the opportunity of being inspired by seeing their footballing heroes play, but not just the children. Of course, we know we want to encourage everybody at any stage of their life to become physically active and being able to watch sporting activity, and particularly in relation to some very important football matches and football tournaments coming up this year, could inspire, we know, a whole generation of boys and girls to take up the sport. So while broadcasting and the listed events regime are reserved, we want a fairer and more representative service for Scotland. We continue to argue for its improvement and ensure that it better reflects and prioritises the interests of Scottish audiences. We'll continue to advocate for the inclusion of national football matches, such as qualifiers for future World Cups and European Championships, to be included in the regime. We've written to the Secretary of State and DCMS on a number of occasions on this matter, but I'm afraid without any reply whatsoever.
Question number four, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what impact the Spring Statement will have on Scotland.
Well, the Spring Statement marks another failure by the UK Government to deliver funding for the people and the public services of Scotland. The combined cut of national insurance across autumn and Spring Statements equates to the loss of up to £1.6 billion in potential consequentials for Scotland. That's £1.6 billion we could be spending further on the NHS, on education, on transport, on our justice services and all of our public services. Health consequentials of £237 million are nowhere near enough, given the pressures we face. They don't cover, for example, the recurring cost of the Agenda for Change pay deal. Based on the latest forecast, our block grant for capital is now expected to reduce in real terms by £1.3 billion by 2027-28. The absence of investment in public services and infrastructure is nothing, frankly, short of a betrayal of our public services by the UK government. Yeah.
Kenneth Gibson.
Answer.
We will suspend once more. It is extremely regrettable that the opportunity of elected representatives to put questions to the First Minister is being disrupted today. And I'd just like to assure members, well, members will be aware of the steps that Parliament has required to take as a result of previous disruptions, but will certainly review today's events because it is extremely, I mean, it's absolutely essential in a democracy that members have this opportunity to put questions to the First Minister. And I call Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the First Minister for his answer. The toxic Tory legacy of Boris Johnson, Liz Truss and Rishi Sunak is that for the first time per capita incomes at the end of this UK Parliament will be lower than at the beginning. Does the First Minister agree with the Scottish Chambers of Commerce that the overriding impression is that the Chancellor's long-term plan to address our economic stagnation has been left for another day? with Citizen Advice Scotland that there was a complete absence of the kind of support those on lower incomes need, and with Douglas Ross, who said that he was deeply disappointed at the one-year extension of the windfall tax to the oil and gas industry is a step in the wrong direction.
First Minister.
I hesitate to say that I agree with Douglas Ross, and I have to say, but on this occasion, when Douglas Ross said the Chancellor's budget was going to harm Scotland, was bad for Scotland, it's probably the first time Douglas Ross has ever been in tune with Scottish public opinion, presiding officer. So disastrous a betrayal of workers in the North East. Apparently, Douglas Ross threatened to resign, but he's still sitting here. I wonder if he sold out the North East for a peerage or indeed to be a Privy Councillor. We don't know, but I'm sure in time, presiding officer, we'll find out, because Kenneth Gibson is absolutely right. The Tories, over 14 years of economic mismanagement, have imposed upon this country a disastrous Brexit we didn't vote for. They've ushered in a cost of living crisis from a government that we didn't elect. And for the first time on record, as Kenneth Gibson rightly says, the economy is set to be smaller in real terms per capita at the time of the next general election than it was at the previous election. And astonishingly, Labour don't oppose a single measure in the budget. So what is what we know, Presiding Officer, is whether it's Labour or Conservatives, that Westminster doesn't work for Scotland.
Yeah. We'll suspend briefly. I call Liz Smith.
Thank you. The Chancellor's budget did actually prioritise improving public sector output and efficiency. For example, £3 billion going to the NHS to update IT and to streamline all the data and AI. Can I ask the First Minister when we will see similar changes in Scotland for public sector reform as the Finance Committee has been calling for?
First Minister.
I mean, brave is one word for Liz Smith's intervention, Presiding Officer, because, of course, we won't see a single penny of that investment this year or indeed the next financial year. They've kicked that investment into the long grass, but of course her party will be out of power, and quite rightly so, Presiding Officer. When it comes to the priorities of the Conservative UK government, what they've prioritised is a tax cut for Liz Smith, a tax cut for higher earners to the tune of £1,500, while at the same time slashing public spending to the bone. That's the priority of the Conservative Party. Apparently, it's the priority of the Labour Party, who don't oppose a single measure in the Conservatives' budget. Is it any wonder, Presiding Officer, that people in Scotland know that Westminster doesn't work for Scotland and only the SNP will stand up for this country?
Question number 5, Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what action the Scottish Government is taking to promote community deer management on publicly owned land.
First Minister.
Through a pioneering pilot project, Nature Scot, that have been supporting community deer stocking at Craigmeggie National Nature Reserve, the initiative giving those living nearby the opportunity to learn deer management skills when fully trained and qualified, giving them access to the reserve to shoot deer in season for their own consumption. Crown Estate Scotland also support access to land for deer management by letting their shooting rights to local shooting associations and syndicates. Community deer management models are common in many European countries, and the Scottish Government's...
We'll suspend briefly. Thank you. We can resume. I call the First Minister.
Presiding Officer, of course, these constant interruptions are deeply frustrating, I know, but of course the issues of food security and poverty are very, very important to the government that I lead, and it's up to protesters to decide where they protest, but I would say to them gently, I think they're protesting at the wrong parliament, yeah, because of course it is Westminster
First Minister,
austerity.
First Minister, I would be grateful if you could address
issues.
Sharon Dowie's
in
question.
In terms of the issues at hand, Presiding Officer, I won't repeat the full answer, but I will say that community deer management models are common in many European countries, and the Scottish Government Deer Board, which met on Monday, discussed the findings from Craig Meggie. We want to ensure that local communities are indeed reaping the benefits as we step up deer management in Scotland to meet our climate and our nature aims.
Sharon Dowie.
Thank you for that answer. There are numerous benefits of community integrated deer management. It builds resilience and opportunities in local communities, reduces the burden of large deer contracts on the taxpayer, and helps protect the environment across areas such as the Carrick Forest in Ayrshire. Local wild venison is a fantastic, sustainable food source to be harvested, processed and consumed that we must champion. And I note the work of the British Association for Shooting and Conservation and the Country Food Trust, who are in Parliament this week. Does the First Minister agree that the Scottish Government must do more work with rural stakeholders such as Basque to bolster Scotland's venison potential?
First Minister.
Well, I agree with a lot of what Sharon Dowie has said. We know that effective deer management can help to tackle the twin climate and biodiversity crisis. Local communities, we want them to benefit from deer management, and they can benefit both in terms of socio-economic opportunities, but also, as Sharon Dowie rightly says, from venison as a healthy and nutritious food source. I'm more than happy to ensure that the Cabinet Secretary writes to Sharon Dowie with details of how we're supporting effective deer management. Of course, I would make the point, as I'm sure Sharon Dowie is aware, that we are intending to bring forward legislation which ensures effective deer management in the context of the twin climate and biodiversity crisis. In fact, the consultation is still open until the 29th of March, but we will continue to engage with rural stakeholders, Basque included, and others, to ensure effective deer management for Scotland.
Alistair Allen.
Can the First Minister say whether the Scottish Government will give consideration to replicating pilots like the one undertaken at Craig Meggie on areas of publicly owned land in the Crofton counties to allow crofters to, subject to the proper training, take in-season deer for their own consumption or potentially selling on, thereby incentivising their participation in this vital strand of nature restoration?
First Minister.
It is certainly worthy of consideration. I think it's important that local communities right across Scotland are able to benefit from deer management through, as I've said, both socio-economic opportunities, but also from the fact that venison is a healthy and nutritious food source. Given the success of the Craig Meggie pilot project, I'm keen that we support more community-led deer management schemes. I know that the Minister of Green Skills, Circular Economy and Biodiversity is looking at what more can be done to establish more schemes, and would be happy to discuss this in more detail with the member.
Question number 6, Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister, in light of International Women's Day on the 8th of March, what steps the Scottish Government is taking to tackle gender-based violence?
First Minister.
Over the past week, there has rightly been a sharp focus on the violence women and girls face, predominantly at the hands of men. We have to stand against that collectively, and we must tackle the societal attitudes and root out the toxic behaviours that underpin those actions that lead to such abuse and to such violence against women. The Government is doing this through our Equally Safe strategy, which focuses on early intervention, prevention and support services. And of course, we want to go further and do more. We also want to transform how our justice system responds to sexual violence and ensure that women and girls have confidence in a justice system which will effectively hold perpetrators to account and, crucially, won't re-traumatise those women who have suffered such abuse. That's why our Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Bill is so important and can also play a major role in supporting survivors and the victims of gender-based violence.
Rona Mackay.
The First Minister for that answer. And speaking about the Government's proposals for a sexual offences court, Scotland's second highest judge, Lady Dorrian, said to the Criminal Justice Committee, and I quote, "The fact is there's no option to do nothing. Either you embed this in a new culture and a court of uniform practice across the country, or you try to embed it piecemeal." First Minister, is it proposals like a specialist court that can build confidence in our justice system for women and girls and improve the experience of complainers?
First Minister.
Absolutely, Presiding Officer. Establishing the Sexual Offences Court, alongside a raft of other measures intended to improve the experience of victims contained within the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Bill, can play a crucial role in building the confidence of women and girls in our justice system. Lady Dorian is absolutely right. There is no option to do nothing. That's simply not an option that anybody in this chamber can or should be considering. Piecemeal reform will fail to deliver the changes in culture that we so desperately need. Those changes in culture, those changes in processes, those changes in practice that are clearly necessary. It's only through systematic reform to our court system, including the creation of a sexual offences court, that we can embed a culture that supports victims, supports survivors of sexual offences, gives them the confidence that they will be treated with dignity and respect within a system that effectively holds perpetrators to account. So I'd encourage everyone in this chamber to support the important proposals that are contained within this bill.
Pauline McNeill.
Image-based abuse is often where girls are coerced into creating or sharing nude images and shared to someone else without their consent. But a report by Revealing Reality, a think tank funded by the Home Office, found it was a particular problem in pupils at school, and it found that many boys sharing nude images without consent was seen as a way to gain respect from their male peers. And the report also found that boys often do not understand what they are doing is abusive. I would like to acknowledge the work the Scottish Government is doing on this, Cabinet Secretary General Ruth and also Minister Siobhan Brown. But would the First Minister consider that we should conduct some research not only on the impact on girls of this, but to examine the extent of it so we're clear what it is exactly we are trying to tackle?
First Minister.
I'm happy to consider the suggestions that Pauline McNeill has made, and I want to pay tribute to Pauline McNeill as well, who's a long track record of tackling, standing up against violence against women and girls in this Parliament. The Abusive Behaviour and Sexual Harm Scotland Act of 2016 does make it a criminal offence to share intimate images without consent. There are a wide range of laws that relate to image-based sexual abuse. But I agree with Pauline McNeill that it isn't just about legislation and laws. They're important, of course, in their own right.
We will suspend briefly. First Minister.
I won't repeat again everything I've already said, but as well as the importance of laws and legislation, which I know Pauline McNeill recognises, she makes a very important point about understanding the nature of the problem, the extent of the problem, and how we deal with that. And I was pleased to be at Moffat Academy earlier this week with the Cabinet Secretary for Education, where we launched our gender-based violence in schools guidance, published this week, and making it clear that the sharing of sexual images was of course unacceptable, but also giving guidance and the appropriate tools to schools to address those issues. And one of the projects that we heard about at Moffat Academy was the Mentors in Violence Prevention Programme, which empowers students, pupils, particularly older pupils, to be able to talk to younger pupils about the importance of issues such as consent and so on and so forth. And I'll continue to do the work that I am leading in relation to positive masculinity, so that we can have and collectively work with young boys, work with young men to eradicate those toxic behaviours we see that are far too prevalent in our society. But I look forward to continuing to working with Pauline McNeill and those across the chamber as we work together to tackle gender-based violence.
Question number 7, Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what action the Scottish Government has taken to reduce waiting times for children referred for a neurodevelopmental assessment.
First Minister.
Well, we know there is increasing demand for neurodevelopmental support and assessments. We do expect that children should receive appropriate support as soon as possible. In 2021, we published a national neurodevelopmental specification. It aims to improve the quality of care for children, for young people and their families. The specification itself, as the member may know, outlines 7 standards developed with children, developed with families and indeed with key partners for service providers, underpinned by the fact that support should be in place when children need it,
rather than dependent on a formal diagnosis. The support is likely to be community-based and should be quickly and easily accessible. We continue to work with health boards and local authorities to enhance support for neurodivergent children and young people, including how quickly they can access the support I've already mentioned. We provided over £1 million to support 5 pilots to implement targeted aspects of the specification. This learning will support wider implementation right across the country.
Colin Smith.
Thank you, President Officer. The First Minister is correct. In September 2021, the Government did set a standard of care. That standard said that children and young people referred for a neurodevelopmental assessment should have an initial appointment no later than 4 weeks. At that time, my constituent, just 10 years old, had been on the waiting list with NHS Lanarkshire for a year. She's now 13 years old and has been on that waiting list for 3.5 years. 3.5 years, First Minister, and she still has no appointment. Her mum told me my daughter has spent a quarter of her life on a waiting list and no one seems to care. First Minister, why does no one care? Why, on your watch as Health Secretary and now First Minister, is that wee girl and countless others having to wait nearly 4 years just to receive an assessment, never mind any care that she may need?
First Minister.
Planning Officer, of course, understandably so, Colin Smith hasn't mentioned the name of the individual constituent. If it is the one that he has written to the Health Secretary about, then we have responded back to Colin Smith, and my officials have been in touch with the Health Board, who say they will be contacting the family imminently. So he has been given an update if it is the constituent that I believe it to be. So we'll continue to work with the Health Board, because I accept fully, without any equivocation, the point that Colin Smith is making, that waiting 3.5, almost 4 years, is simply not acceptable. So that's why we're providing funding to our health service, to our health boards, in relation to tackling some of these issues, and of course making sure that over the course of the last few years we've continued to prioritise mental health funding to record levels under the SNP government. But if he wants further information about his particular constituent case, he's more than welcome to write back to the Cabinet Secretary for Health. But my officials have contacted NHS Lanarkshire and asked for an immediate update.
We will suspend briefly. First Minister.
I ended, Presiding Officer, I think by saying that my office have been in touch, my officials have been in touch with NHS Lanarkshire, and we do hope for this particular family that there will be some progress very soon, and happy to continue to liaise with Colin Smith on this particular constituent case.
Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Diagnosis is an important step on the journey when seeking support for the diverse range of conditions that fall under the umbrella of neurodivergence, but many other steps do come after. Can the First Minister provide any further information regarding the steps the Scottish Government is taking to champion the rights of neurodivergent people?
First Minister.
The Scottish Government is committed to championing the rights of neurodivergent people. I'm very grateful to Karen Adam for raising this issue. Again, she has a track record of raising such issues in this chamber. And we are currently consulting on proposed Learning Disabilities, Autism and Neurodivergence Bill, which will aim to ensure that the rights of neurodivergent people, including autistic people, people with learning disabilities, are respected, are protected and, crucially, are championed. Karen Adams will be aware, of course, of the consultation, which runs to the 21st of April of this year. Additionally, the Scottish Government and COSLA, supported by Inspiring Scotland, have partnered with people who have experience and stakeholders to establish a new leadership and engagement framework that puts people's voices and experiences firmly at its heart.
Rachel Hamilton.
Many children coped with the challenges of the pandemic, but those already struggling with mental ill health, the impact of lockdowns and lost schooling, are likely to have made their condition worse. And shockingly, in the Borders, just 40% of young people started CAMHS treatment within the 18-week target. To remind the First Minister, his own target is 90% in 18 weeks. First Minister, no more lame excuses. Will your government get to grips with this scandalous CAMHS crisis now?
First Minister.
Officer, again, there's no doubt, of course, about the impact of the pandemic, not just in relation to young people's mental health, as Rachel Hamilton rightly points out, but of course in relation to the demand on our health services. And that's why I referenced in an earlier answer the latest statistics that have come out in relation to CAMHS, which of course show that there's room continued for improvement, but we are seeing a recovery in our CAMHS services, and of course continues to show that under this government there is significant investment in CAMHS, but also in staffing of CAMHS. But we also, of course, are ensuring that there's investment not just in CAMHS, which is crucial and it's vital, but also in those pre-crisis interventions as well. And that's why we're providing local authorities with £15 million per annum to fund community-based mental health support for children, young people and their families. And from local authority reports, in the first half of 2023, more than 58,000 children, young people and their families access community-based mental health support. So we'll continue to invest in our NHS with that record investment of over £19.5 billion, and continue to make progress along that journey of recovery that we're very firmly on.
Thank you, First Minister. Unfortunately, the opportunity for more elected members to represent their constituents by putting questions to the First Minister has been disrupted once again. I think we would all agree that the principle of this Parliament being open and accessible is extremely important. Visitors are very welcome to attend to see their elected representatives at work, but not to disrupt this work. And again, I would say to colleagues that the Parliament will work with security colleagues and with Police Scotland and will take any further action that is required in this regard. That concludes First Minister's questions, and we will now suspend briefly to enable the chamber and gallery to leave.